Sridhar Konda, Associate Professor, Marine Engineering Department, MIT University. Today, our topic is in the Marine Auxiliary Machinery, we are going to cover heat exchangers. The course code is ME501. In this objective is, we are going to see that operation, maintenance and various materials and various troubleshooting. This is the objective of the course. So, now we will go into the topic heat exchangers. Heat exchanger is an equipment where two fluids flow separately but adjacent to each other, so that the heat is transferred from hot fluid to cold fluid. Okay. Heat exchangers are classified as coolers, heaters, condensers, evaporator. For example, main engine lubile cooler. In this, the hot fluid is lubile, whereas the cold fluid is seawater. Heat is transferred from main engine lubile to seawater. And heater, for example, main engine fuel oil heater. In this, the heat is transferred to main engine fuel oil from the steam. Steam is used as a hot fluid. And condenser, in the condenser, fluid is condensed. And for example, in the freshwater generator condenser, vapor is condensed, and in the evaporator, one fluid is evaporated by heat transfer by taking heat. That is, example is in the freshwater generator, there is evaporator where the heat is transferred to seawater and it is evaporated. Now, we will go into the how various types of heat exchangers on board ship. So, shell and tube heat exchangers, plate type heat exchangers, and shell and coil type heat exchangers. Again, slight change. Different flow patterns, parallel flow. In the parallel flow, both the fluids flow in the same direction. In the counter flow, the fluids flow in the opposite direction. In the cross flow, the fluids flow at right angles to each other, and this is mixed flow where the fluid is flowing through all across the tubes. This is the shell and tube heat exchanger. These are the tubes in which the cold fluid is flowing. This is the shell in which the hot fluid is flowing. And these are the end covers. This is the end plate. In the end covers, there are anodes for protecting from corrosion. This is how the heat exchanger looks like. This is the shell, tube stack, end tube plate, end covers. These are gaskets or O-rings. What are the materials? We discuss about the various materials. The shell is fabricated of stainless steel, cast iron. Tube plates, basically they are usually naval brass. These are alloys of copper, zinc and tin, and tubes, aluminum brass, and head, the cover is made up of cast iron. So, what is the working principle? Generally, the hot fluid flow through the shell and the cold fluid flow through the tubes, and there is single pass and multi pass. In the single pass, the fluid will be flowing through the tubes and straight away it will come out. In the multi-pass, the fluid will enter in one side and take a U-turn, comes out this side. There is a division plate here. There is a division plate which separates the lower part and upper part. baffle plates. How the baffle plates? Baffle plates are basically they support the tube stack. Also, they divert the fluid onto the tube stack so that there will be a better heat transfer. These are the tube stacks. The performance of the heat exchanger is affected by various factors: air locking and fouling, and sometimes the division plate gets a hole. In the fouling case, we have biological fouling, particulate fouling, precipitation fouling, different foulings. Now, especially the tubes are choked with this fouling, which will affect the heat transfer. Now, arrangements for linear expansion of the tube stack. How the tube stacks are accommodated for linear expansion? There are three methods. One is the tube, one end of the tube is fixed, other end is freely floated. The second method is both tube end plates are fixed, but shell is allowed to expand. And the third method is one side of the tubes are fixed, and other side the tubes itself can expand in a stuffing box. So, we will discuss about this. This is where the heat exchanger, one side of the tube plate is fixed and the other side of the tube plate is free to float. Here both tube plates are fixed, but the shell is free to expand. The third method is one side of the tubes are fixed in the tube plate, the second end the tubes can expand freely in the stuffing box. These are the three methods how the tubes can take care of during heat transfer, expansion, contraction of the tubes. Now, arrangement for indicating leakage at the free end. The tubes you want to take the tubes at the end, there are two O-rings which will separate the two fluids, and in between there is a lantern ring with a hole. This will prevent mixing of the two fluids. This is the enlarged view where it has got two O-rings, and this is the telltale hole through which any fluid is leaking will come out. Regarding the maintenance of heat exchanger, it is how it is important to do the work safely. Before carrying out any maintenance work, carry out the risk assessment, identify various hazards and mitigation procedures. So, and also take valid permit before doing any job, and notice has to be displayed properly. Before attempting any job on the heat exchanger has to be isolated properly, walls has to be locked, and do not rush to open the covers because we are not sure the walls are holding. So, ensure the depressurize the heat exchanger by opening the vent walls, ensure there is no pressure inside the heat exchanger, then only open the end covers. And check always the anodes condition, end cover condition, and if required change the anodes, and check the tube condition, and tubes have to be wire brushed, ensure all the tubes are clean, and check for any other debris or foreign metals objecting. And time, these are the various tools used for cleaning the heat exchanger. So, operating the tube heat exchanger, to maintain the correct temperature, always ensure minimum water is flowing in the heat exchanger. Excess water promotes corrosion and waste of power. So, control the temperature by regulating outlet of the heat exchanger, never throttle the inlet of the heat exchanger. Keep air out of the system by venting it properly. Avoid freezing in cold weather. and regularly maintain the log and ensure that temperature difference is maintained properly, pressure difference monitor, and identify the condition of the heat exchanger by regularly monitoring the parameters. Now, we talk about plate type heat exchangers. Why we have to use plate type heat exchangers? What are the advantages and disadvantages of plate type heat exchanger over tubular heat exchangers, tube type heat exchangers? Now, the plate type heat exchangers are very compact in size and the heat transfer efficiency is very high. They require less space for maintenance. These are the main advantages of the plate type heat exchangers. Also, to increase the efficiency, the plates can be added in pairs whenever you want, or the plates can be removed if required in pairs again. So, the main advantages is that compact, they are compact and very efficient. But what are the disadvantages? The main disadvantage is the cost of the plates. The plates are very costly, and that the plates are made up of titanium steel, and the o-rings are made up of nitrile rubber. So, they are very expensive. That is the main disadvantage. Other disadvantage is identifying the leaks and rectifying the leaks, and these are the main chief disadvantages. Pressure difference due to obstruction, that is also one major disadvantage. Okay. Then, plate type heat exchangers, this is the alpha level plate type heat exchanger, where we are going to talk more about. This is the one end of the plate is always fixed, other end is free to float. This is the plates inside the plate heat exchanger, and different patterns in plate corrugations, different patterns in plate corrugation. Why plates are corrugated? First of all, plates are corrugated, these corrugations will increase the heat transfer area. So, the net area will be increased, so the efficiency will be increasing, the heat transfer is more effective. Also, they promote turbulent flow, so that there will be again heat transfer will be increased, and also they give additional strength to the plate to withstand high pressures. So, because of this, the plates are corrugated. However, one has to remember the plates are very expensive, very expensive. So, the shape has to be taken care. This is the plate type heat exchanger. One end is completely fixed. The other end of the plate is free to float, free to move. In case of any maintenance we have to do, this free flow plate can be moved along the frame. So, before that, see the clamping bolts, and before doing any maintenance, again one has to carry out the risk assessment and identify various hazards, carry out the risk assessment and mitigation procedures, and isolate the heat exchanger properly and vent out, open the vents, ensure there is no pressure before dismantling. How to dismantle? This, before dismantling, read the manual carefully and measure the distance between the plates at the top, middle and at the bottom on the both side. Make a record of these measurements, because we have to ensure the plates are not over tightened or plates are not slack at the end of the maintenance work. These readings will be very important. Now, open the clamping bolts carefully, uniformly, without damaging the shape of the plate. After removing the plate, move the plate to the other end and clean the plates properly with a wire brush and check for any deposits, clean the deposits. Make sure the o-rings, the gaskets are not damaged, because they are made up of nitrile rubber, very expensive. Make sure the gaskets are not damaged. and after cleaning thoroughly, and the ensure the plate should not be, the plate number should not be altered, or position you should not interchange, because they have specific pattern. You have to follow the same pattern as specified in the manual. Now, the while assembling, ensure the gaskets are properly stick to the plates, and if required with a glue, special glue, you paste the gaskets back to the plates. And this again, while tightening, these plates have to be tightened in a specific pattern as specified in the manual. This is to prevent over tightening in a particular area, either top or bottom. This will, which will change, cause changes in the shape of the plates. So, this is to prevent the plates getting damaged. So, we have to follow the specific pattern as specified in the manual. Also, do not over tighten, as we have taken the readings before dismantling. Ensure the readings are maintained, do not over tighten or do not leave it slack. These are the various photographs, leakage pattern, leakage. Yeah, so why identifying the leakage, rectifying the leakage is a very big task in plate type heat exchangers. So, one has to be very careful during maintenance. Once they, if there is a leakage, again the entire heat exchanger has to be removed, each and every plate has to be checked, and the damaged gasket has to be replaced. So, it is again a big task. So, one has to be very careful while maintaining, while doing maintenance. Generally, there is one more method, that is now in the latest method, cleaning in place. This is recently in some standard ship companies, the heat exchangers are maintained in place without opening by chemical cleaning method. The heat exchanger, some companies, they are specifying that the heat exchanger has to be opened once in 10 years. Before that, every year this has to be at regular intervals, this has to be chemically cleaned. So, why we cannot dismantle it? Basically, this is to prevent gaskets or plates getting damaged by repeated maintenance. To prevent that, so in place we can do it chemical cleaning. This is the most modern method of cleaning plate type heat exchangers. And sometimes you can do at back flushing. What is this back flushing? Fluid flow in the reverse direction, one of the fluid will be flowing in the reverse direction, for example, seawater. Seawater, we have to divert it so that it will flow in the reverse direction. The walls are already provided. This will remove all the debris, whatever the clogging in the plates, that will be removed. And the, after that, the performance of the heat exchanger will be improved. So, at regular intervals, this plates have to be, this plate type heat exchangers have to be back flushed. Okay, we discussed many things about advantages. However, there are lot of disadvantages also there with the plate type heat exchangers. One is, as I said, cost is the main drawback, because the plates are very expensive, they are titanium material, and the gaskets are nitrile rubber, which is very expensive. So, one has to be very careful while handling heat exchangers about the plates and gaskets. And another problem is that the deterioration of joints, as we discussed. Another problem is that leakage of the tubes is very difficult to identify. The location of the leakage is very difficult to identify, and rectification also cubosum takes longer time. So, one has to be very careful. So, and sometimes the pressure drop, pressure differential between the differential pressure between the fluid inlet and outlet will be high. Because of this reason, the shell and tube type heat exchangers are preferred. So, compared to plate type heat exchangers because of the pressure differential. So, to summarize, we have discussed about various types of heat exchangers, classification of heat exchangers, coolers, heaters, condenser, evaporators, and shell type heat exchangers, plate type heat exchangers, shell and tube type heat exchangers, advantages of plate type heat exchangers, and disadvantages of plate type heat exchangers. We have the maintenance, how to be carried out the maintenance on plate type and shell type heat exchangers, and the various materials used, and we have discussed. I hope you enjoyed the lesson. Thank you.